So basically, as sir mentioned, I would be giving overview of the relapse prevention. These are our learning objectives for today, basically to understand what relapse prevention counseling skills, and also to understand the prevention strategies, and to know how to do relapse assessment and manage relapse effectively. To give you an introduction,
yes.
The abstinence from alcohol and other mood altering drugs is essential part of treatment of chemical dependency. So we expect that there should be a phase of abstinence or not taking alcohol or other mood altering drugs. So treating fraternity always looks for this kind of outcome, that is abstinence. However, because the dependency is a kind of thing which impacts the person's physical, psychological, and social functioning, the treatment has to be designed in all the areas. So abstinence, to attain the abstinence, it is not just the medical treatment that helps, but when we take into consideration person's physical and psychological and social functioning into consideration, a multidisciplinary team approach generally helps in treating the chemical dependency. Some of the treatment goals that have been highlighted by Gorski and Kelly in 1996, which suggests four important treatment goals. They are primary treatment goals for dependency in alcohol or other drugs. First thing is, this particular dependence is a biopsychosocial disease. So understanding and recognizing that this is a biopsychosocial disease is the first phase of treatment. Then recognizing that this particular dependence needs lifelong abstinence. It is not that they are abstinent for 3 months, they are abstinent for 1 year, so they are absolutely fine. No, we cannot come to such conclusion when it comes to chemical dependency. So we have to recognize that there is a need for abstinence over a period of time, and if possible, lifelong. Another goal that they have highlighted is development and use of an ongoing recovery program to maintain abstinence. So it is not that one time they take treatment and then they come for follow-up every now and then. Along with that, I think there should be a recovery program to maintain the abstinence. That always helps in the process of treatment. Another aspect is diagnosis and treatment of other problem or conditions that can interfere with recovery. It may be other medical conditions, it may be other psychosocial problems, it may be related to employment. So taking into consideration diagnosis and treatment of other conditions also very, very important in the process of recovery. Hence, detoxification is alone not adequate treatment for addictive diseases, what we have to understand from these goals. So now my main component, concept of relapse. So relapse is something that is returning to heavy or problematic substance use following an extended or brief period of abstinence or moderate use. So there should be a period of complete abstinence if more likely, or else at least moderate use or the much, much lesser use than the previous usage. So returning to heavy or problematic substance use can be considered as relapse. A more cognitive way to understand relapse is an unfolding process in which the resumption of substance use or continuation of substance use is the last event in a long consequence of maladaptive responses. There would have been many other maladaptive responses, which I also will be talking briefly. There are various ways of maladaptive responses this particular individual would have tried. But however, there, in the end, when they are not able to utilize any of these maladaptive responses to the internal or external stressors or stimuli, one can get into the phase of relapse. So there are two terms that we need to be clear here. One is lapse and relapse. Lapse is something which is a single incident of substance use. It is a shortcoming or a slip, which may or may not result in a relapse. But the relapse is an individual wherein an individual returns to a continuous pattern of using substances after a period of abstinence, as we seen before. relapse is not an isolated event. Rather, it is a process of becoming unable to cope with the life of sobriety. So the life of sobriety that they have planned or with the treating team, it has been tried, it does not last long. So the person becomes unable to cope with this life of sobriety. So then it becomes relapse. So earlier relapse used to be considered as a failure of an individual or failure of the treatment or inability to handle or control one's emotions. So the process of relapse now has a different meaning. Actually, now relapse is considered as a part of recovery process. It is not considered as a failure in the treatment anymore. So that is an important learning you need to have from this session. So as I was mentioning, there are stages of relapse, which are considered into emotional relapse, psychological relapse, and physical relapse, as told by Gorski and Miller in 1986. The book Staying Sober, A Guide to Relapse Prevention. Basically, the forthcoming presenter next session will also be talking more in these lines on emotional relapse and other things. So basically what we need to understand here is that there is a first stage where the individual starts penting up his or her own emotions, not being able to express, maybe having a kind of emotion that are not very healthy within themselves, or not able to follow certain routines that they have to follow, not able to manage themselves in a very normal situation after the abstinence, then they are in the process of emotional relapse. So when the emotional relapse itself is forthcoming, if they come for a proper intervention, I think they have a high chance of going back to abstinence. But however, when they are not able to handle by themselves, nor they take any help, then they get into a phase of psychological relapse. That is basically they are not able to handle their own emotional phase of relapse. Then there is a more and more stress which are formed inside their mind and body, and they have a high chance of suggesting themselves that yes, this can be relieved only through drinking or using other substances. So they come almost into a convincing stage that no, I'm not able to handle, in psychological relapse phase. So from there, then again they get into the physical relapse phase, where these emotions become very hard to control, and they think that the ultimate decision of taking alcohol is the only solution, or substance is the only solution for this kind of pent up emotion. So they get into consumption of alcohol or substance. So this is a kind of stage of relapse that we need to keep in mind when we see any patient. G. Allen Marrett has given beautifully the cognitive behavioral model of relapse process. So we need to, this is very simple diagram which actually explains us how a person can get into the phase of abstinence, or can avoid getting into relapse, or how a person with the situations can get into addiction. So if you see here, this is the point of situation, that is high risk situation is a main thing that one has to understand. Then there are two ways of determinants which goes in with this high risk situation. One possibility is that when they have a high risk situation, the person may have a healthy coping responses. That healthy coping responses leads to increased self-efficacy. And when they have increased self-efficacy, there is a decreased probability of a relapse. However, in other situation where the coping response is not healthy, where they are unable to handle the high-risk situation in the healthy manner, it leads to decreased self-efficacy, which actually makes them think positively, like positive outcome expectancies out of substance effects. So they always think, okay, for this coping, I need to get into substance use, because that itself will make me feel relieved. So then what happens? They get into initial use of substance. So that becomes an abstinence violation effect. So the whatever that they had managed and maintained in abstinence gets completely changed into abstinence violation effect, where they perceive that the effects of substance is much more positive way, like how here positive outcome is there. So then they get into increased probability. There is a chance of high chance of relapse. So Marlett's cognitive behavior model talks mainly on high risk situation, which goes in this particular direction. And then he talks on intrapersonal or environmental factors. So I'm sure you would have heard or read, or you, many of the previous sessions would have covered many of these. So I'll just move faster on this determinants of relapse. Basically, environmental or intrapersonal relapse talks about, or determinants talks about negative emotions, which may be anger, frustration, anxiety, depression, boredom, loneliness, or negative physical or physiological state, which may be a phase of withdrawal or craving, pain, illness, fatigue, enhancement of positive emotional states. Like as we were mentioning, the positive outcomes are often thought with the substance or alcohol. So then testing personal control. I can manage by myself. There is no problem in handling. So let me try once. So this kind of challenges with friends or within oneself. So these are some of the determinants which the individual can get into. And giving into temptation and urges, unable to handle the temptation and urges, one person can get into relapse. The other part is interpersonal, which again, we all would be able to understand when I just say arguments, jealousy, discord, guilt, anger, which maybe between the people, between the individuals or between the groups, then worry, concern and apprehension, maybe with regard to employment, with regard to interpersonal problems with other members, social pressure, which may be peer pressure or increased sex or celebration or pleasure kind of moments can also may make the person get into relapse. So another important concept Alan Marrett had discussed is covert determinants of relapse, in which he basically talks how a lifestyle imbalance can lead to relapse. So there should be the hypothesis is there should be a balance between perceived external demand that should and want, the conflict between should and wants, and internally fulfilling or enjoyable activities. For example, there is a constant state of stress, then that leads to a kind of negative emotional state that is all are little bit of towards wants, then increases the desire or for pleasing or rationalizing the indulgence. So this is how this is how an individual can easily get into with their cognitive difficulty in cognitive management of the wants, the difference that they would not be able to make between shoulds and wants can get into relapse. Another important aspect that we need to understand is when we have a client who has come in the face of relapse, what are the basic 10 things that we can ask? This is apart from what the medical fraternity or the doctors have to ask, there are certain other psychosocial dimensions also can be looked into in the process of relapse, because we have discussed that it is not just biological thing, it is biopsychosocial disease. So we may have to consider many of these aspects in the process of assessment. So which may be a reason, and when we are doing this assessment, as far as possible, we have to be non-biased. None of these questions should look that we are going to confront the patient, or we are challenging the patient, or we are asking to prove that the patient is wrong. No, this is basically with all the due respect to the individual, we are just asking them where this high risk situation was, or where the trigger was, or what is that we are deriving out of this particular phase of relapse. That is the main aspect that we need to keep in mind. So when we are asking reason for relapse, duration of relapse, this is all basic information is what we need to tell the patient. Average intake during the relapse, last intake, medication compliance, with the medication have they taken, without the medication have they taken, or for how long this medication compliance they could maintain. So this all gives us an idea as to where this particular individual sometimes fails to become compliant. time taken to seek help from the time to relapse, and what were the relapse management the individual within himself or herself tried doing, then responses to relapse, whether they had remorse or guilt, or it was the responses of own self, responses of the family for this particular state of relapse, then abstinence violence violation affect, we were telling what is the justification they are giving for this particular relapse, and commitment towards abstinence, what is the level of commitments they have, or what is their orientation of abstinence they have, duration of last abstinence, status of social support, because sometimes these dimensions also can have an impact, because you are an alcoholic, already been an alcoholic, so that kind of tag that they have, what is, because of that, what was the social status, and because of abstinence, what was the social status, this gives us when we involve in therapeutically also with the patient. So then employment status, motivation, recent stressful life events, which is again very important, and ongoing stressors, if any. So all these areas are very, very important for us to understand in the management process. So to give you some of the key questions, I think this particular slide will be sent back to you. So some of the same questions that are highlighted there have been repeated here. So I'm just skipping. So now we are coming to the main aspect of relapse prevention. So far we have discussed what are the stages of relapse and what are the cognitive behavioral model of relapse. Now we are somewhat moving into the next step, which is a prevention process. So relapse prevention is a systematic method of teaching recovering patients to recognize and manage relapse warning signs. So first step of relapse prevention is manage or recognizing and managing the warning signs. So it becomes a primary focus for patients who are unable to maintain abstinence from alcohol or drugs despite primary treatment. So according the primary treatment would be medication and maybe lifestyle modifications to some extent, but with that, when they are unable to come to the level of abstinence, then relapse prevention techniques is a very useful technique in the managing alcohol or substance use disorders. So some of the techniques that I have briefed here, they are basically the strategies that actually it can go in order, or it can go in as per the assessment that we have done. But however, most of these preventive measures have to be applied to an individual to see a better outcome. It includes clarifications of myths and misconceptions. Many a times there are those who have maybe with the individual or the family have a lot of myths and misconceptions that this can never be done, this person will never stop alcohol or substance, or it may not be possible for me. So this kind of myths and misconceptions, or this is needed for me, so little bit in a day is very healthy. So there are very many myths and misconceptions, and maybe if you do a brainstorming, you will also come up with many such myths and misconceptions that exist in the community. So we have to, as a first step, we have to do the clarifications of these myths and misconceptions, and assessing high risk situation. Again, we have discussed in at length craving management. I'll be briefing it on that. Drink refusal skills, very important that we involve patient and the family in the process of this, mainly the patient in identifying drink refusal skills, and then train them and then do the regular follow-up. Problem solving skills, coping skill training, anger management training, money management, sleep hygiene techniques, very important, and lifestyle modifications. So these can come under relapse prevention strategies. So basically make you understand that relapse or the recovery post relapse is does not progress like this. It is actually like this. This is the understanding patient and therapist, we both have to have. So that means to say that we need to have more patience, we need to have more expectations which are in a healthier way, and also should not feel easily frustrated because despite our attempts, this person has not been able to achieve. So it is always a humpy bumpy road. So let us keep this particular diagram in mind when we touch upon the recovery or relapse prevention process. So one of the main things that we have to keep in mind is the abbreviation HALT. This particular abbreviation helps us to understand, or it also helps the patient to educate on relapse prevention. That is, these can be high risk situation, which is hunger, anger, like being bored or lazy, then tired. So these are the four important abbreviation, four important things that can lead to a relapse. So help patients to list out their common causes of relapse, maybe within these or apart from these. So these are the one important thing that we need to keep in mind. What are their high risk situations? How they get, there is a possibility of relapse. Then when we talk about craving management, we have to keep in mind 5 Ds. That is, they will have, as I said, there is a emotional, then psychological, then physical phases of relapse. So when we understand that where exactly they are, it will help us to give them managing, how they have to manage this particular craving. So it may be drinking water, deep breathe, delay in getting into the action. Even if there are several times that comes to my mind that no, I have to go now. So delay by 15 minutes, delay by half an hour actually can help them not to go for the substance use. Then discuss with therapists, discuss with their family members, discuss with the doctors. So that can help. Divert or distract. The fifth D is divert or distract. So these 5 Ds are important components in the process of craving management. So other aspect is handling peer pressure. So many a times this is the common cause explained by the people who went into the phase of relapse, that this is because of the peer pressure we got into that. So avoid them from first contact as far as possible. Be firm, repeatedly say no, then don't feel guilty for saying no. These are the few things that you can do with peer pressure. Then problem solving steps. I think this is the common diagram that you will remember, how we have to get into breaking the problem into smaller steps and identify solutions. And when one solution does not work, how we have to think of alternative methods of solutions. So when we have 5-6 solutions like plan A, plan B, plan C, one of the methods will work in delaying or staying abstinent from alcohol or substance. So keeping in mind two important types of coping skills, that is emotionally focused coping and problem focused coping, can help the individuals to actually handle their craving. It may be accepting the responsibility emotionally, or avoidance or distancing. Problem focused, basically taking the help of social support, taking the help of social surroundings and planning the problem solving process, or positive reappraisal by the individual to himself or herself or by the family members, and confrontive coping, challenging my own craving problems. So I am pushing myself far beyond my ability to get out of this particular craving. So these kind of confrontive coping also can help the individuals. So as we know, anger management, there are many techniques, maybe cognitively or psychosocially one can apply, which you can go through. Then lifestyle modification also sometimes a very useful technique, which can be towards positive addiction. So how you have an addiction to this, likewise you develop a positive addiction. Sometimes we hear people how they are addicted to going to gym or going to walking or physical exercises. So that's a kind of positive addiction. So then getting them into recreation and spirituality mode also is a very good, very helpful methodology for handling the craving. So there are certain times beyond their capacity crisis can come, maybe a problem that they are unable to handle or cope with. So in such times they have to actually take the help of case manager or seek the medical attention immediately. So if there is any lapse or a relapse possibility because of the crisis, one has to immediately take the help, and case manager will always be able to help in the crisis intervention mode. So there are various phase of relapse. I think due to the time limitation, I will just highlight few of the things. So each individual can or as a therapist, we need to keep in mind this, any of these phases can be or warning signs for a relapse. It may be internal change, which may be biological change in terms of sleep or hunger or anything. And the denial within the individual's mind that I am able to control myself. So these kind of denial, or this is not a big problem at all. So that kind of denial, avoidance and defensiveness. Every time I avoid a problem that comes to me or defend that why I want to go for alcohol or substance. Crisis building, because not sharing, because not taking the help of the medical fraternity, the crisis which builds within, so which actually leads to immobilization, not willing to go for help, not willing to take help. So all these can be warning signs. Then confusion and overreaction. For the mildest cues or a stimuli, the individual can be confused or overreacting. So sometimes depression, sometimes behavioral loss of control, sometimes recognition of loss of control, and option of reduction phase. Though there are options of reduction phase or harm reduction phase, that itself for not a healthy situation for some alcohol or substance user. So we should keep in mind what kind of reduction phase is useful to the individual. Then end of it, when none of these warning signs they could overcome, then they will get into alcohol or drug use. So these are the various steps or phases that can come in each individual's life before they get into relapse phase. So overall, what we are just winding up with the overall take-home message. Important issues that we need to keep in mind is what is the level of motivation of the individual. That is the first and foremost thing. In your previous session, you have identified about motivation or you have learned about motivation. So it will actually help you to understand or assess the person, what is the level of motivation, and then high risks, understanding high risk situations, then handling cravings and triggers, then helping them with drink refusal skills and coping skills and problem solving skills, then helping them to handle stress and help them to manage their time, sleep hygiene techniques and enforcing positive addiction and healthy lifestyle modifications, and supportive family environment in the process of recovery is another important aspect in the relapse prevention. Many a times it is individual based problems, and many a times it is family induced problem, alcohol. So including family in the process of recovery is very, very important. So at the end, a relapse occurs when attitudes and behaviors revert to one similar to those exhibited when person is actively using alcohol. Basically, it occurs when the attitude and behavior is not in the sync. So thus, relapse prevention is an evidence-based, empirically supported practice for substance use disorder. Recovery is a structured plan for living that builds a foundation upon which the patient can function effectively and comfortably. So this particular person to come to this particular phase of recovery, so relapse prevention is one of the important component. Thank you so much. There are a few further reading suggested here.